Hello everybody, are we all in? Hello, can you hear me? Am I audible? Yes, Akanksha Mishra, okay. Fine, good afternoon Arpit, Shivam. What is QCOM? QCOM. Good afternoon, Madhi, Sumesh, Trifna, Apurv, Shalini, Abhishek. So some names are more regular, but some names keep on. Had a good lecture. Yes, yes, it was nice. A bit hectic, but fine. Okay, thank you for asking. Good afternoon, Shruti, Vikas. Yes, Akshima. Okay, fine. I have uploaded two videos. I hope most of you are managing to view all of that. I have uploaded one CCMP session I have uploaded because I had a good discussion on regions. So I think region is always important. Have a look at that. And I also uploaded the morning session. Some of you could not attend that session. So the geographical thought is important. So I've uploaded both. And I've kept both the uploads public for everybody. So please feel free to use it. And though I keep insisting on this, I'm not really sure if all of you are following the methods diligently for studying on online sessions. See, do not just watch the video. This is all useless. You must sit down with a notebook with some kind of a paper, pencil. You need to pause, note down. So a 2-hour video can sometimes take even 3-4 hours. And of course, you can always watch at a higher speed. But you need to pause and take down your notes. That's the reason why I'm sharing all the recorded sessions eventually with you guys. Like, it's becoming difficult to manage GS. Shruti, congratulations. Welcome to UPSC mains preparation. Now, when people tell me before the prelims they have problems of time management, I always tell them, wait for the main examination. Okay, then you understand how prelims was actually manageable. Koi baat nahi, Shruti, keep on fighting. Keep on struggling, keep on fighting. In this examination, there's nothing called as perfect preparation. You'll never have perfect preparation. No matter what you do, no matter how much you revise, you always have something or the other that keeps getting left out. Okay? And you must have the type of emotional control in yourself so that you can handle this. Okay? Rishabh, essay is the real menace. You are not following the sessions on the Telegram, are you? I have discussed almost 20 topics now. Even if you just revise the stop, it will be enough. Anyways, give me some time. Once my MSP session gets over, probably mid of August, I'll spend some time helping you on the essays also. That's the bonus program you can have for yourself. Okay? So we'll do that. No essay course as of now. Maybe towards the later part I might have after your main gets over. But for the mains, I'm doing what I can. Okay, so let this grind be over because do your geography well. Okay, do geography well. Keep your GS work. Keep pace with the sessions on the Telegram. Last 2 days, we have taken a break. Okay, you should be working on it. Okay, let's get started now. Okay, I think most of you have joined, whoever had to join. So yes, let's start off now. So achha, by the way, before I start off, the two topics of thought remain. I'll be back on it. Let me first explain one concept many of you have been asking me. What is the difference between post-structuralism and post-modernism? Okay? So this is not a question as such, and they probably will not ask you this. But if you know this concept, you can use across many answers. You can use it across many discussions. Okay, so what is the concept here? So one is as I'm discussing what is the difference between post structuralism and postmodernism. Okay. Now, for this, first, do you understand what is Marxism? I have discussed this, but I will doing it again quickly for you. What is Marxism? Marxism has two, three features. One is inspired by political economy. Marxism talks about class divides. Marxism talks about, okay, general theory of Marxism, application to all areas, irrespective of location. Marxism looks for solutions by changing the political economy. Okay? And Marxism is anti-religion. It is anti-culture, and so on. Achha. Now, from Marxism, there was a development towards structuralism. Okay. In structuralism, all of Marxism is fine. But what they're adding is there are deeper reasons that are, there are many implicit factors. Okay, because their allegation was that Marxism addressing problems at a very superficial level. Okay, imagine there is a rich man, there is a poor man. This is the class divide. Class divide. Why is the poor man poor? Because he has no resources. Why is the rich man rich? Because he has resources and he also owns the modes of production. Modes of production. So what's the solution? Solution is the rich man has to be overthrown. The poor man takes over resources and it's done. This is Marxism. Now you come towards structuralism. This school says there is a rich man, there is a poor man. Okay? The poor man is poor again because of no resources. The rich man is rich because he owns. Okay. Now, the solution is not simply overthrow this. Okay, that's the ultimate one. But the solution lies at addressing the problem at a deeper level. The deeper level includes beliefs and practices that implicitly further class exploitation. Now, these beliefs and practices, this is about not simply the existing economy. Okay, this is about some kind of traditions. Okay, like think of the tradition called as slavery that has perpetuated the class divide. Okay, it's very much part of a culture now. This slavery is very much part of culture. Or think of women subjugation. This is part of culture, the patriarchal culture. Okay, that makes the slaves and that makes the women labor class. Okay. So it says that don't just address resource distribution. You must look at some of the traditional historical factors, which include beliefs. Now, the whites had a belief that the slaves are inferior. The men and women both have strong beliefs that women are inferior. Okay, so try to address it. But understand, at the end of the day, whether it is women or slaves, they are still looking at the issue called as labor. They are still addressing the issue called as class divide. Okay. They are still looking at the problem from the perspective of political economy. Okay. They are still looking at the problem called as political economy. And they're trying to challenge traditions. Okay. They're trying to challenge traditions. So Marxism and post and structuralism are not too different. In fact, structuralism may be considered as extensions of Marxism. Okay. And I repeat, the wisdom is still around political economy. The objective is still around looking at people as a labor class and addressing the problems of the labor class. You're still talking about the economic aspects. See, we can look at oppressed societies in two ways. Okay, there are two ways of examining and appreciating the problems of the oppressed class. Of the oppressed population. One is you treat them like labor and you try to empower them by making them the potent factor in production. The second way of dealing with them is the idea of liberty, the idea of freedom. And liberty, freedom, not only in terms of economy, not only in terms of economy, but freedom, liberty also in terms of religious beliefs, in terms of language issues. So in this approach, when I'm still looking at the problem from the political economy, this approach has gone beyond political economy. Okay, so I do not treat the people as labor alone. I'm not looking at solutions from political economy alone. I'm not looking at wages as a problem. Okay. I'm not looking at as productivity as an issue. So this has gone beyond the structural or the functional aspect. Okay. We also call this Marxism and post-structural and structuralism as They are theories in utility. We are still looking at labor class fulfilling some utility in terms of production. So this is the Marxian idea. This is structuralist. Whereas this idea, which says, no, look beyond labor, look beyond wages, look beyond political economy. This is post-structuralism. So post-structuralism is looking at divides in a society. That's why they use the word the structure. The structure basically means something around hierarchy, around divides, inequality. Okay. But the divide and the solutions to divide are not looked into only from the perspective of industries, production system, productivity, only in terms of wages. Okay, so the new feminism is not only about making women a part of a production economy. Okay, the gender rights are no longer about economic participation and the wage rights of women. It's beyond that now. We talk about reproductive rights. We were talking about women empowerment for the sake of women empowerment, not necessarily to make them into a productive labor. So this is what we mean by structuralism and post-structuralism. So post-structuralism is into religion discussions, culture, tradition, language, ethnicity. So there is a lot of a commonality between postmodernism and post-structuralism. Okay? Postmodernism talks about no grand theories. Okay? It talks about this concept of feelings and sense of place. Post-structuralism can be seen as an extension of that idea, more or less. Okay? So post-structuralism, postmodernism, feminist geography, these are the new developments in geography. So have you all understood the concept now? Okay, do you understand the concept now? Okay, wait for secularization. Which part? I said the post-structuralism is going beyond the Marxist interpretation. It is going beyond the Marxist class economic interpretation. It does not look to solve problems in terms of wages alone. So how can you say, Shruti, both are same? After half an hour teaching, you're saying both are same. Structuralism and post-structuralism are not the same. Okay? Post-modernism, better refer to the first two classes. I've taken two classes on this. Look at the first two sessions. So post-structuralism goes beyond the Marxist and political economy explanation of, the struggles and inequalities. Okay, so the same inequality can be seen in many ways. You can look at the caste system in the structuralism connotation, where you look at the class and the labor class issues as same, or you can look at class even beyond that, as an issue of identity, as an issue of, maybe a cognitive level of subjugation. Okay. So that is not structuralism. It goes beyond. It goes beyond Marxism, but Marxism not solving the inequality alone. It looks at the belief systems also. Okay. The concrete difference. Okay, look at the screen again. Marxism only talks about change the ownership, the problem is solved. Change ownership, struggle, the problem is solved. Structuralism says simply changing ownership won't solve. Okay. The ownership is the issue, but to deal with it, get into some beliefs that perpetuate it. So structuralism is still talking about political economy. It is still talking about wages, it's still talking about poverty, but it says simply changing the ownership will not change the problem. You have to go a bit more deeper, But structuralism is still fundamentally based on political economy and wages. Like, structuralism is still about labor class. Whereas post-structuralism says, it is no longer about economy alone. Like, it is no longer only about labor issues and poverty. It's also the aspects related to empowerment, which is beyond political economy. It's like, you know, I teach the girl child. Why? Because the girl child can become productive labor for earning more wages. If I do that, that is Marxism and structuralism. But I teach the girl child because she deserves to be taught, because she is human being, because she has some beliefs, and I must fight patriarchy that stops her not to grow. And I don't take the discussion towards economic always. I don't take it towards jobs and labor issues alone. Then it becomes post-structuralism. Okay? So post-modernism is Marxism plus post-structuralism, yes. To that you also add new regionalism, new regions. You also add humanism. And postmodernism is not really Marxism because Marxism was ignoring space. Postmodernism inspired by Marxism, but postmodernism is including spatial aspects. Okay. No, Sonu Bhatt, you're getting it wrong. Okay. I think I'll leave it here now. I've said what I had to say. You need to view the video again, make your notes, it'll be more clear. Okay, so I'll let it go now. Fine, let's move ahead. So now we'll move on towards the questions of geomorphology. Okay, I'm moving towards geomorphology now. Now, the first question that we had was, yes. The first question that we had was, geological characteristics with climate change can be potent serious disaster hazard for the country. Okay? Geohydrological characteristics. Lot of chat here. I'm leaving cultural hearth and I'm leaving secularization right now. That'll take too much of time. I can't progress. I'll come back on it afterwards. Okay. Do the other questions. Okay. Leave these two questions. Let's do geomorphology and have a sense of completion first. So geohydrological characteristics with climate change can be potent serious disaster hazard for the country. Comment. Now, I have given you one type of format for your answers on geographical thought. What type of format you can follow for geographical thought. Now I'm telling you what can we do for other topics. So in geographical thought, what is the answer? What is the answer format? In thought, I had said, broadly keep to this. Have an introduction of definition maybe. Get into a bit of history. Okay. And in history introduction, you can use a diagram. Then get onto the body. In the body, use the name of scholars. Give examples. Use technical inputs, whatever you can. And then in the conclusion, you can be a bit more critical. You can summarize. And most answers can go towards postmodernism or post-structuralism. So this is more or less the format for geographical thought. Now for other answers of geography, this is what I'm suggesting. Have an introduction. Those who are from CCMP will understand this. Others, listen. Have introduction. have a diagram. Okay. Then you come to the body. Now, this body should have analysis. By analysis, I mean you are relating something to some factors and you are explaining it. In the body, you can refer to some geographical concepts which are unique to geography students. Like say, while discussing climate change, global warming, refer to heat budget. That's typical for geography students. When discussing waves, tsunamis, talk about tsunamis that are shallow water waves. You can talk about the wave depth and wave base and discuss. While talking about cyclones, you can have the concept of centripetal force, subgeostrophic winds. You relate it to upper tropospheric conditions. That's hardcore geography. Only a geography student will know this. When you talk about floods, you can talk about hydrological aspects like rock type, rock property, permeability, porosity, slope controls. So that brings geography. So in the body, the objective is the answer should look like a geography student's answer. Even if the question is phrased as a general question. This is a common problem I face, okay, from students. Sir, the paper was very general. The questions were very general. We could not answer, okay, like geography students. It looked like a GS answer. Now listen, this is something I always tell students. Your questions may be general in terms of the vocabulary used, but your answer, it's your choice. The answer can be general GS type of answer, or your answer can be very specific with hardcore geographical concepts. Now, this is the art that we want you to learn. Okay? And how do we do that? How do we write answers which have geographical concepts? So analysis. And in analysis, when identifying the factors, you look for geographical factors. Use terms from geography. Okay? When you're using geography, you are using concepts which are unique to geography students. A third way is regional comparison. Now you all know how important regions are to geography discussions. So regional comparison, say they talk about floods and flood problems, you can give a small regional comparison. The floods of Northern Plains are not same as the floods of the hill areas. The floods of urban regions are different from the floods in the irrigated regions. The floods of Malabar coast region, not same as the floods of the Brahmaputra Valley region. So when you are having regional comparisons, say discuss the soil problems of India. So one good nice method is talk about the soil problem from the regional perspective. And just talk about soil problems of dry regions, soil problems of hill regions, soil problem of deltaic regions, soil problem of badland regions, and you go on there. So regional comparison is a very nice tool, okay, of bringing geography. And another way of bringing geography is, because you're using a regional concept, so what you can do is use tools from geography. And these tools are maps. Tools are sketches and diagrams. Okay? And finally, you have your conclusion. The conclusion, unlike thought, where the conclusions are generally some critical assessment or the conclusions are summaries, For other answers, I suggest let the conclusion be some applied aspect. And applied aspect, stretch it towards its relevance for India. Okay, so talking about discuss the forests of the world. Okay, forests of the world. When you end the answer, you can mention that Indian forests also are great diverse, like the world forests that reflect climate. Indian forests also reflect climate. The typical forests of India are monsoon forests, and India also has unique forests like Shola forest. The applied aspect, forest management is a very important component of India's development aspects. The forest management is a very important part of India's land use policies. Recently, forests are being integrated into agriculture systems like in agroforestry schemes. So you have moved on towards applied and also Indian aspect. Say you have a question, okay, dealing with problems of global demographic growth rates or rates of fertility. So after having talked about the world, you end the answer towards that India also has a lot of regional variations in fertility. And there are a north-south divide in India. There is an urban and a rural divide in India. Applied aspect, that understanding the fertility is the important part of managing developmental programs. That India needs to reduce the TFR. India needs to address the problems of multiple childbirths. Okay, and high TFR in India has led to some issues. So take discussion towards India, the applied aspect in India, and also some discussions of the concept for India. So these are some of the suggestions I have for you when you write an answer which are of the generic nature, but you must convert that into a geography answer. Any question in this? Any question in this? Anybody? Okay. Yes. So it's fine. Yes, exactly. In fact, paper 2 will be less difficult for you because it already has the Indian perspective. The challenge might be for some generic topics where you'll have to think on how to apply. Okay. So paper 1, paper 2 answers, there's no formula beta. Understand this format more or less, and then you can keep on moving between the schemes. So just as I have shown answers for geographical thought, I'll show you some answers in the GS paper. In fact, there was one session in CCMP, I have done this extensively. I'll share the link of that video also. How important are facts? So Yash, without facts, your answer is going to be very, very bland. Like you'll be bluffing essentially if you have no facts. For you need the facts so that your answer now becomes a bit more objective. Okay. So let's get on to our discussion of the question. The question was geohydrological characteristics with climate change can be potent disaster for the country. I believe you have done the work now. Okay, you understand what are geohydrological problems? Characteristics, I'm talking about slope, I'm talking about percolation, I'm talking about sediment texture and those factors related to sediment movement down the slopes. It also includes whether hard rock or soft rock and how they're vulnerable to erosion or deposition. We're talking about depositional aspects also. So geohydrological as in geology plus hydrology. Okay. And to this, you're adding climate change as in heavy rainfall, climate change as in storm surge and cyclones, climate change and cloud bursts, climate change and droughts. Okay, so for example, if there's an area which has clay content in its soil, the clay content is the geo and hydrological aspect. To that, if I add delay of monsoons, if I add rainfall problems, you end up having drought conditions more severe because clay can now become hard, difficult to plow and manage. Okay, so if looking at hill areas, the geological aspect of hill areas, they are slopes. they will have less percolation, higher runoff. To that, if I add cloudburst, now you're going to have a major problem of landslides, okay, and mud flows, like what we had in your state of Kerala last year. So this is how you're managing. Okay, so I believe you understand these issues. Now, let me give you an example of such an answer. Okay, so the answer to this is, look this up. You can all see my screen. Okay. Now look at this answer, please. Look at this answer. Okay. The same format. Initial, some introduction. Then you come to a diagram or a sketch. And then you're moving on towards the main body. And as far as body, you have to keep the body to the topic asked. Okay. And finally, you'll have a conclusion. Acha, by the way, when I'm saying draw a diagram here, does not mean don't draw a diagram elsewhere. This diagram, a schematic, it helps you give a pictorial representation at same time, a presentation at same time. It also helps to conserve words. Okay. Doesn't mean that you should not have diagrams elsewhere. Diagram elsewhere also required. Now see what it has been done. What has been done? So as the UN IPCC says, the planet will reach some facts, the temperature by 2030. To this, if it adds your hydrological characteristics, it impacts livelihood, it impacts climatic events, magnitude impact, food shortages, water shortages, and so on. And this was forced in here, Malthusian theory of growth. Okay, why? Because food shortages, so something, but not the best one here, but that's okay. Then this is a schematic about telling you how the disasters can impact some social aspects, the water problems, soil moisture, food production problems, freshwater problems, circulation. But this schematic, I'm not very happy with. Why? Because in this schematic, it does not look like you're talking about the geohydrological aspects very explicitly. Okay, so it's a nice one, very detailed. One, it gets a bit clumsy if you have too many such relationships. Second, the geohydrological aspects is not well captured. Okay, but this is a diagram. Then what has been done is series of subheads like climatic variability under climate change and river drainage aspects. What can that do? So a drying river valley, maybe resulting in extreme weathers and what happens thereafter. Okay, look at this. Okay, so consequences. Now again, in this section, the geohydrological aspect has not been well discussed. It only says, there is climate change variability and the river has gone dry. Now, river growing dry, you have to link it to the geohydrological aspects. You should have linked that to probably problems of salinity because of more evaporation. Why? Because the soil is such that it tends to trap water. Okay, or because the sediments are loose and water is more, if you can result in more erosion and more deposition downstream, causing more floods. So you had to link the discussion to the geological aspects. Yes. So the heading is there. The heading is there, but this heading has not gone towards the geohydrological aspects. Look at the next heading. Glacial retreat and mismanagement of dam structure. Now this is definitely related. So dam structure, slopes, seismicity, on top of it, glacial retreats, and how they can cause problems of floods downstream. Okay. Again, this could have been better. So steep slopes, heavy rainfall. Okay. We can have river avulsion. You can talk about river changing course. So that's an example of geohydrological aspect and the climate change. Then it says climate change, sea level rise, and decreased river runoff. Okay. And seawater mixing with the groundwater, something around the coastal areas. Okay. Blocked river runoff. Okay. Urban heat island. So if you see the answer, in this entire answer, let me come back to discussion point here. Okay, first maybe have a look at the answer. I'm leaving the answer on the screen for some time. Look at the answer, then I'll come back on it. Don't be in a hurry. Spend some time on some of these answers to understand what can be done for these. Okay. Okay, suicide farmers, migration, disease outbreak, man-wildlife conflicts, glacial warming, melt slow, water levels, reservoir, seismicity, livelihood again, climate change, cyclone, Chilka Lake, impacting wages. Okay, urban heat island, urban flooding. Okay, something on mitigation, local level, community level, national level. If India wishes to be 5 trillion economy, the link to some current affairs, India's impact. Did you see the pages now? So what's your comment? You've seen the answer? So can you tell me what is your comment about the answer? Yes, the geohydrological aspects are not highlighted. Okay, very nice. What else? It's towards climate change. That's understood. The question wasn't climate change, but the climate change had to be linked to the geological aspects. The geological aspects are missing, exactly. Yes, it's about groundwater, but you must link the groundwater aspect to percolation. Okay, residence time, slope of the land. Yes, to some extent you are right. It's a bit too clumsy also. The visibility factor is not very good. Okay. So think of this as the examiner, what the examiner is feeling. Okay, look at somebody said clumsy answer. You're right. I do not know where does one end, second one starts. Ye heading hai, ye underline hai, ye heading hai. So simple thing would have been number them. A, number it this as B, number it as C. Leave some space between paragraphs. Okay. Now social aspect is important because we're talking about disasters. But the geological aspect could not have been missed. Even this diagram is pretty clumsy here. Okay. Sonu, I'm trying to teach you. Listen, okay, if this is what you had to write, why would I have been commenting on the answers? Okay. Very strange question asking me. You must not write like this. This answer is organized. Do you all agree or not? Here, listen, all of you. Is the answer organized or not? Is the answer organized or not? Yes, it is organized. There are subheads. You can see sections. It is organized. Achha, number two, is the answer rich or not? In terms of points and issues covered. Is the answer rich or not? Yes, it is rich. Okay. Is the answer within word limit or not? Yes, it is within word limit. Okay. More or less, okay, 2.5 pages or 3 pages, that's okay. Okay. Now, the challenge for this answer was the answer is missing what the question is demanding. The question demands something else. Okay. So the relevance is missing, correct? And second, the presentation was not very good. So this is not how you must write an answer. Okay, not at this answer at least. So what you do is this. Okay. What you had to do is this. You had to link. Okay. You had to link the geohydrological, which means talk about runoff. Talk about sediments, talk about channel slope, talk about texture of rocks and sediments, percolation as a function of rock properties. So when you say this, this is geohydrology. Yes, somebody said groundwater, correct? Link it with terrain aspects and rocks. Now, climate change, yes, it can be dry, it can be wet, it can be very, very wet, it can be hot. So hot evaporation, link that with these some aspects. Dry, again link with this, because if it's dry, dry area, no rains, plus igneous rocks. This will ensure I don't even have groundwater. Wet conditions plus soft sediments. What happened with Kerala floods. Okay. Very hot conditions with coarse texture. I will end up having again problems of water. So you had to link this. So again, climate change plus Himalayan slopes. What this can do. Now, a very important part of the answer or question you're missing is the question has the word called comment. So in the comment, you also had to give, wherever possible, some kind of you could have disagreed also. So one way of doing that is saying that climate change is reality. Geohydrological aspect is also a reality. These two we cannot change. But how we can change is dealing with the mitigation factors. So the vulnerability of the region is not simply because climate change is happening or there are some natural hydrological aspects. The mitigation factors includes forecasting, it includes evacuation, it includes slope management, it includes developing water harvesting systems. So our conclusion here is climate change and geological aspects, they are a potent threat. Yes, they are possible hazards. They're possible disaster, they're potent threat. Okay, but if I can take care of the mitigation aspects and I can take care of adaptation also. Okay, then the disasters are pretty well managed. Now, ye wala part answer mein bilkul bhi nahi hai. The problem lies with forecasting. Our problems lies with slope management, like afforestation. Okay, so if we can do all of that, then probably our disaster proneness will not be as much. Are you all with me? Can you see my screen? Oh my goodness. Oh, you didn't see my screen. Oh. Come back to this. Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Chalo, I will do this again. Okay. I'm discussing this again. Is it visible now? Is it visible now? Yes, okay. So what I was saying is, I'm quickly summarizing this, okay? One is, you cannot miss the geohydrological aspect, which includes soil aspects, land properties, slope considerations, channel aspect. Okay. You have to use these terms, not simply dry condition, more floods, more droughts. You have to use something from hydrology, even groundwater. Okay, and give examples. This was one. Second, I said is because the question has comment. So you can do some value addition here. You don't have to quickly jump and agree. You can say that the climate change is a reality. The geohydrological aspect is also our reality. But what we can manage is our mitigation and our adaptation. A very important aspect of this is think of forecasting of cloud bursts, evacuation, okay, anticipating landslides. We're looking at water, okay, management techniques. So our conclusion here is ki, yes, climate change with geological aspects can become tricky, but if our mitigation and adaptation aspects are right, like if India can include disaster management appropriately, then these can be handled more smartly. That's the point. Okay, so I hope you have all got the answer now. Okay. So just because you have too many points, just because you are drawing diagrams, does not mean your answer is right. Okay, yes, watershed, exactly. Okay. Was explained? Yes. Explained, you have to do the second part less, but even then I'll say add a paragraph that this is only part of the story. Okay, so even if it had said explained towards the end, you still can talk about how we can mitigate the problems or how can we adapt the issues. Diagrams, okay, diagrams at least have one small sketch per page. Okay, have one small sketch per page. Yeah, dredging and all you can use, no problem. Geohydrology related to, okay, the geological aspects that determine and control the water flow systems. Okay, fine. Let's move on now. That's one answer done. Look at the next question. Write a note on ergodic reasoning in geomorphology. So some of you probably patiently looked up the net also. Okay, that's nice. But for others, listen to this. What is ergodic principle? It's very unlikely you've heard about this. Okay. What is ergodic principle? Now, in landscape studies, one of the most important challenges, or one of the biggest challenges, how do we reconstruct the history of the past? How do we know what was the landform earlier and how it has changed? Okay, this is the biggest challenge. Why? Because the processes are slow. Okay, there are multiple processes involved. Lot of old landscapes are now destroyed and so on. Okay, the challenge. Now, there are three ways we can do this. There are three ways how we can study landscapes and how they change. One is, we can use mathematical models. Okay, we can do some modeling. Mathematical models. We can use some statistical tools. I can also use computer simulation today. Okay. And mathematically, I can find out that if this is the mountain today and the rate of erosion is X, probably after some time T, the mountain is smaller. And at time t minus 10, the mountain was larger. I've used some equations here. I found out the rate of erosion, the rate of deposition. I found out the potency of the erosive forces. Okay. And then I do mathematical modeling, mathematical equations. I use statistical tools. Okay. I try to use statistics. And then use computer modeling. I can tell how the landform has changed. The second way of doing it is, I can make some kind of a crude model. It can be a crude physical model. And actually simulate some erosion process. Like think of the way we study aerodynamics in wind tunnels. So I'm actually making a model, a crude model, in which I am studying the effect at a smaller scale. I'm actually seeing it. Okay? Yes, even this involves mathematics, but this is different from this. Okay. This also uses mathematics. But here the entire thing is mathematical equation. It is nothing physical. In this case, using mathematical models, I'm able to simulate a real process physically. I can simulate a process physically. Okay. The third method, I go to a place called A. I found a mountain, okay, which is, say, 20 million years old. And I find there is a river flowing. I go to another place called B. I find a mountain which is 50 million years old with a river flowing. I go to another place called C. I find a flat plain. It's probably 200 million years old. And I find a very gentle river flowing here. And I relate the three together. I'm relating the three together. That a young mountain is higher and the river is smaller. As the mountain gets older, the mountain becomes more subdued, the river grows. And when the mountain is as old as this, it becomes a plain and the river now becomes sluggish. Now, this is a type of deductive reasoning. Based on a couple of examples, I have developed a theory, then I'm checking the theories. These are based on real life like examples. And very importantly, in this method, what we have done is we have substituted space and time. So the place called as C represents a time 200 million years old. So now I've made a model. A mountain is becoming a flat plain. So when this mountain now becomes 200 million years old, it is a flat plain. So in reality, A, B, and C are three different locations. I have now related the location with time and have developed a time-based model. This is what is called as ergodic principle, where time and space are interchangeable. This is ergodic principle. Ergodic principle is based on present is the key of the past. If I go to a place and I find some landform there, I can infer about its processes. So it is based on Hutton's principle. These type of models are also called as allomorphic models. Allomorphic as in form. I study the shape. I study the forms. I study dimensions, and then I conclude. So ergodic principle is a kind of principle which was the basis of all historical studies. It was the basis of all models of Davisian concepts. Is that okay, all of you? Today, an ergodic model will have lot of speculative generalizations. Yes, uniformity is correct. So when you are building back the denudation chronology, exactly, this is ergodic principle. You're studying 2-3 locations, understand that. Not mathematical modeling, it is 2-3 locations, based on which you are telling us that the locations are representing time. Allomorphic. Morphic means study of forms, study of shapes, the dimensions. So based on study of forms, I'm trying to interpret the past history. This was the basis of Davisian model. Is it okay? Allomorphic, A-L-L-O, morphic. That's exactly, this will be too much of generalizations. When the structural differences are there, I'll have a problem. Yes, ergodic principle is based on studying palimpsest topography, is correct? So entire geomorphology of historical school is based on ergodic principle. And now we're trying to use mathematical modulations and simulations now as an alternative to ergodic principles. But very unlikely we can replace ergodic entirely. So now look this up. Look at the screen now. Same principle. There is an introduction in the top. There is a diagram schematic. And then there are concepts explained. You have to just mug this answer up and use this concept in any answer that you have. So they might ask you ergodic, but even if you don't ask ergodic, make sure you're using this concept in Davisian model You're using this concept for time-based models. You're using it for historical geomorphology equations, erosion surface, and so on. Now let's read the answer. It says, the first sentence is around definition. So ergodic reasoning in geomorphology is the proposition that under particular circumstances, time and space can be considered to be interchangeable. Okay, so we are explaining now. Okay, in the ergodicity hypothesis, okay, time and space are interchangeable. In denudation studies that don't use this, okay, they are not always interchangeable. Okay, you can have a dependent variable, you can have independent variable, but you cannot change time and space. The method is scientific. Okay, the other methods are more subjective. But then scientific, but does not mean it has objectivity. It has, again, a lot of probability studies here. It requires a lot of field studies. Okay, and you could have added study of forms. So that's ergodicity. So space, time, location, time substitution. In ergodic geomorphology, a common practice is to study change through time by identifying similar landforms of differing age. Okay. And then arranging them chronologically. You study landforms of different age at different location. Now, this is an important sentence. This is where I think, okay, you study different age at different locations. This is an important word. And then this location is replaced by chronology. It's a kind of an equilibrium, and you can go on thereafter. Okay, look at the next page. Okay. So modern rivers, Great Plains, okay, allometric models have used this. Explain allomorphic or allometric. Okay. Models have used this. Location time, where the reliability depends upon the accuracy of landform chronology. Okay. More useful where absolute chronology is unavailable. When some area lacks the stratigraphic evidences, just some layers are missing, some rocks are missing, then you must do this kind of comparison across regions. Okay. So pitfalls, okay. Some landforms may be of different structure, problems of relicts not available because some surfaces are destroyed. Okay. The same problems we have for erosion surface applies here. And finally, ergodic reasoning. Ergodic reasoning can aid efforts to environmental reconstruction, predicting tool, analysis of river system, its history, forecasting trajectories. You end up the answer by saying that the technique is a very nice technique which was used by Davis model, but then now we are using more and more the computer and the mathematical simulation, okay, which are not always based on time and space interchangeability. Okay. I hope you've understood what is ergodicity. Any questions here? Yeah. Any questions here? Okay, fine. Because if you remember some of the answers, you'll be able to modify better. Okay. What is GM? What do you mean by GM? Geomorphology. Yes, yes. Yes. It is geomorphology. Yes, Darwin's subsidence theory is ergodic principle. Correct. Correct. Okay, let's move on. Next question. Next question was, what are some types of river modifications and how do these modifications impact channel and hydrological characteristics? In fact, question number one and question number three are pretty much overlapping. Okay, I hope you all have the questions with you. What are some of the types of river modifications? How do these modifications impact channel and hydrological characteristics? Okay, so before I discuss the answer, I would like you to see this answer. So I will not comment till you have seen and you tell me what you think. Okay. Yeah. This is a topic I've taken straight from textbook. Okay, straight from textbook. This is part of anthrogeomorphology or anthropogeomorphology. If you have read through this, which I expect you should have read through, anthropogenic. This is in page number 573 of Geomorphology by Samindra Singh. 573, 574, and 575. Okay? Even if the question not exactly asked, but the concept is still relevant for you. So read this answer once. I'm leaving it on the screen. And then I will ask you for your inputs. What are some of the types of river modifications? And how do those modifications impact channel and hydrological characteristics? So please make your notes, make your jottings. We will discuss thereafter. And the same principle I follow. We have introduction, followed by a schematic or a diagram. Then the body is there with geographical concepts. Okay. Sediment, downstream erosion. Okay. Salinity, dry season, can go on there. Next page. There's a case study also. I forgot, yes. To make your answer more geography, this is a very important tool. Use case studies. 3-4 lines on a specific example. We call that as case study approach. Way forward, what can we do? So the applied aspect is here. You could have added some Indian angle also. River modifications dated by Roman times, deforestation, urbanization, soil erosion, sediment supply, river velocity. Okay, guys, tell me now. What is your comment? Intro is good, good answer, well arranged, answer is fine, anthropogenic causes, balanced, natural river modification is missing, good answer, geological aspects, you could have had more on indirect modifications, not found impact well, interlinking of river as an example is missing. Fine, there's a case study you would have added. Yes, Pawan. Less link between river modification and hydrology and channel pattern. This answer has written or has mentioned what is the impact of intervening on the river system, but it does not relate to the hydrological or channel geometry and the channel morphology aspect. Okay, so if you remember, getting back to our screen, okay. Now see, this is what you had to do. You had to bring in discussions from channel morphology. Channel morphology. I have taught this extensively and I have also shared the videos with you guys. Discussions around how is the velocity, the depth of the river, the width of the river, how are these related to discharge? Discuss the sediments and how that impacts discharge, how they impact the course of flow. Discuss the sediments and the channel property, something called as alluvial channels, bedrock channels. You can also discuss meandering. If you remember something, channel morphology and the course disruptions. So we have discussed something like what is avulsion, what is chute cutoff, what is braiding. Okay. What is river derangement? So this answer is missing the elements of channel morphology. Okay, so there are very specific discussions here. That if we are impacting the, like say, modification called as river training. In river training, what we do is we fix the width of the river. The discharge increases. If you do this, what happens to downstream ecology? Okay. If we are modifying, say, deforestation, dams in the upper stretches, how this impacts the downstream velocity? How it impacts downstream sediment load. Okay, if I'm having water diversion, what does that do to the meandering? If I have sudden overflows like dam release, what that does to meandering? So you will have to think on these lines and then make your answer. So this answer was missing this almost entirely. And we need examples on this. Okay, so from northern plains, from coastal plains, from the hill areas, there are Chambal regions. And how this knowledge can be important for applied aspects. Yeah. So that answer was not the best answer, but I deliberately keep some of the answers from which I can teach you. So we'll try modifying the answer, and the modified answer we will share with you. Do you have any questions on this now? In fact, even in the previous one, where we discussed the geohydrological characteristics with climate change, we again could have linked it to a lot of aspects about channel properties. River rejuvenation, yes, if you can add the idea called rejuvenation, static rejuvenation because of higher water. River capture, but a river capture is kaise aayega? You're talking about how does man modify? So what does the man do in capture? Okay, I do not know. Breeding, yes. You had to know a bit on channel morphology first. So try this answer again. Okay. And then we'll discuss this maybe in another session, whether the modified one is fine or not. Okay. Let's move on towards another answer now. Okay. The next question is, okay, question number four, I don't think I'll discuss. If you have got question number one and three right, the four will not be a problem. What are some of the important geomorphological considerations important for development of hill regions of India? Okay, so you know there are floods. There are problems of water shortages. There are problems related to issues of deforestation. So hill area development, you can handle this. Okay. I thought I had an answer on this. Let me check up. No, not this one. Not this. We just have a framework answer for this one, not really an answer. Okay. No, we don't have an answer for this. I'll let you know afterwards. Okay, you'll do on its own. Now, what are cliffs? Okay. What are cliffs and how are they formed? Now, this again is a straight answer. Question from your textbook, what are cliffs? You look up your section of fluvial and also your marine geology. Okay. So, how are they formed? Now, something like this is the next question. So, I can show you. Sorry. I have moved on. What are cirques? What are cirques? So cirque and its formation, I can discuss. I jumped. I'm sorry. So look at this. The same format. Have introduction. Have some diagram. Come towards the body. In the body, a good way of getting a bit of geography is, okay, refer to theories and concepts of geography. So one here, okay, another one we have is here. Okay, we have this theory here. Draw diagrams, and towards the end you can take it towards some aspect of applied. Okay, so same principle I'm applying. Okay, so look at the answer. Nothing much to add. I presume you know the concept called cirques. If you do not know, doesn't matter. Even then you can have a look at the answer, memorize the answers. So across landform chapters, some landforms are important. You'll have to go through them very quickly. Okay. The cirques are glacial, erosional landforms, armchair-shaped, steep-walled, depression, okay, form youthful stage. This is a concept of geomorphology. a diagram to explain what it looks like. There are crevices, very deep one called Bergschrund's. There is a head wall, and there is a toe here, the threshold. Okay, conditions is all from the books. Nothing that I have added. It's just that this is in an answer form. The book that you have will not have the answer format. Okay, so page number 482. 482. So what I've done is I've picked up one or two landforms which I think are discussion-based answers. So I've taken that up. So cliff I've taken up, cliff apne aap dekhoge, but this is an answer of the other one. Okay. So theories that tell us that they may be the consequence of frost action, which is wrong. The most acceptable one is it's because of the glacier scooping out, digging out the slope of a mountain. Okay. So some diagram here in terms of the sequence and the conclusion. So what's your opinion on this answer? What's your opinion on this answer? Anybody? Yes, you will get the answers, Kapil. I'll give you the answers to you, and the answers I give you, please mug it up. Okay? So if this answer is worth, say, 15 marks, how much marks can you give this answer? Applied aspect is there, but a quick mention, that's all. 12, 11, 8.5. If I was taking this answer, I would have given even 13 or 14 also out of 15. Because such an answer in the exam condition is impossible if you have not practiced and by-hearted it. Okay? So if I was giving this and this was done in exam conditions, I would have given 13, 14 also out of 15. So what you say is 10, 11, that's a very, very, you can say, a very modest presentation, nothing near this. So mug it up. Two, three answers of this kind, your answer writing skills will dramatically change. Mug up these answers. Don't think twice on that. Somebody's asking me on the cliff. Page number 451. Page 451. Okay, 452 and 453. Just on the lines that we have this one, somebody can write the answer on a cliff also. Yes, I will, Soumya. I will share the answers. What will I do keeping the answers with me? Once I've taught you, I'll share the answers with you. Okay? So let's move on from here. The next question that we have. Differentiate edge planes from pediments. Do you know what edge planes are, or do you want me to explain it to you? What are edge planes? Okay. What are edge planes? Yes, you know it. Please explain. Now, edge plane, quickly I'll write the points down. Edge planes are one type of erosion surfaces. Okay? Edge planes, these are one type of erosion surface. So they are flat, almost flat. Highly denuded, they're old features. Like edge plane, we also have penny plane. Like edge plane, we also have pedi planes. We have pediments. We have cryoplanes. And we also have pan planes. all of them are examples of erosion surface. They all look the same. The important point here, that they all look the same. Flat, near base level, okay, very old. The difference lies mainly in process and the conditions in which they form. Process and the conditions in which they form. Now, peneplain's Davis model. Pediplain, L.C. King's model. Pediments. Pediments are like pediplains, but we have other theories explaining them. Okay. Cryoplanes, product of periglacial models. Panplane, forget for now. Okay, so peneplain, entire Davis model process applied it here. Pediplain, L.C. King's model, scarp retreat, and so on. In fact, pediments, pediplains are one types of pediments, plus there are other processes also that create it. Okay, so I can refer to a page number here. Okay, so we have got recessional theory, page 472 and 473. They explain how pediments are formed. Page 472 and page 473. So what does a pediment look like? What does a pediment look like? So, if this is the desert, mountain deserts, okay. So there is an elevation, a very flat moving surface. There is some depositions here called as the bahadas. And then we have lake here. This surface, which is an erosion surface, this is what is called as pediments. Pediments are pediplains. If I go by L.C. King's model, but pediments are also formed by other processes. Okay, we have some theories here. H-plane is one type of erosion surface. And H-plane is a feature of savanna conditions. Now, savanna conditions, two things operate. We have the process of L.C. King operating savanna. We also have other models. In your book mentions M.F. Thomas model. Your book mentions Pug's model. H-plane, the feature which is formed by this. We don't use the H-plane if I'm going to use L.C. King's ideas. Okay, so H-plane term I use only when it is forming by this process. If it is by L.C. King's model, I use the term pediplane. What's differences in the H planes, chemical weathering, deep chemical weathering is important. So I have a surface, this deep chemical weathering, very thick layer of rocks which have undergone chemical processes of disintegration, and then this layer gets removed. So chemical weathering is the main process by which etching happens. Is it okay, all of you? Did you understand the concept called etching now? Pediments coalesce to form pediplanes. No, pediments coalesce to form peripediments. The pediplane is used in the context of L.C. King's model. Okay. Now, yes, I know some of you know this, but then not everybody in this batch is part of CCMP, so you are going to be patient here. Okay, so I quickly have done this. Now, please look this up. I'm showing you an answer now. And I'll maintain the same format. The first paragraph or first few lines is introduction. What are pediments? And you can open the book and write. The idea is to know answer writing first. Okay. Introduction is a broad surface, extensive surface, sloping area, gentle sloping, given by G.K. Gilbert first. H planes are okay, plumation surface, etching. Okay, so you could have added the idea called deep chemical weathering. What does an H plane look like? What does a pediment look like? Climatic conditions, pediments can be anywhere, arid regions, semi-arid regions. But H planes are features of savanna type. What are the forces that create? So pediments are because of fluvial processes plus something else. Whereas, okay, H planes are because of intense chemical weathering given by M.F. Thomas. Process, pediments are formed because of back wasting, recessional erosion. Etching is related to removal of weathered sediments. What are the landforms related? Okay, so for pediments, I can talk about depositional bahadas, lakes, and the rest. Okay, explained in Selbergs also. Examples straight from the book, nothing else. Did you get the organization? The one thing we could have added in this answer was, if you could have some more diagrams on the process of formation. Your book has a diagram. Pediment, page number 473 has a diagram. Okay, we what we call as progressive recession of the mountain front by McGee's model. You could have used that. Okay, and the arid, semi-arid landscape, page number 477, that has talked about H plane. Or use a schematic as to what are the differences, sum up the entire, like one of the diagrams could have been a schematic that's, or maybe table maybe, that sums up the differences. So go through this answer again and tell me if you understand. Okay. Fine then. Second page here. Is that okay? Any questions on this? Any questions on this? Savannah cycle is page number 475, 476. Uluru in Australia is in Selberg. Okay, not an example of an H plane, but it can be part of the process. Any questions here? Page 2 again, this is the page 2 I'm showing you. H-E-T-C-H beta. H plane is page 477. Look at the last paragraph. 477, last paragraph has H plane. Okay. So I'm moving on. What are the types of shorelines? I'm moving on, okay? What are the types of shorelines? The reason I gave the questions beforehand is I was expecting you spend 4 or 5 hours and do some jottings. Okay? So shoreline classification of Shepherd. This is again straight from the book, but showing you how the answer is organized. 2, 2.5 pages. This is from the chapter of marine features. You can expect this time because all other chapters they have kind of asked. Okay, so coastal features you can look up a bit more carefully. Shepherd's classification is in 459. Page 459. Same format. Start with some introduction. Use some diagrams, some schematics. Then explain the body, what are the types or stages that they go through, the primary coastline, secondary coastlines, submerged coast examples. So you again have diagrams here, Ria, Fjord. So these answers, I will post them hopefully today itself. Okay. This is straight away from page 459. There is one Shepherd's classification, page 59. And there is one more scheme called as Johnson's classification, page 457. So Johnson's classification is here. Just for sake of completion. I said, no, one good way of getting geography is get some names which are typical geography, okay, content. So compare with, unlike Johnson's scheme that talks about shorelines as on the basis of, okay, you know, whether they are emergent, submergent. Okay. Shepherd's classification is more on the basis of what type of agents. Okay. I don't think I need to teach this to you. You know Gocheng Leong. Fjord coastlines, Ria coastlines, neutral coastlines, compound coastlines, and Shepherd schemes includes all of this together. Similarly, any questions on this? Any questions on this? Okay. I am moving on in that case. How to conclude, differentiate type of questions. You sum it up in terms of what the features in general are. Which book? We're referring to Geomorphology by Savinder Singh. I thought you know this. We are following Geomorphology by Savinder Singh. I have an older edition, but the page number remains the same. Okay? The page number remains the same. Okay, guys, I'm getting repeated reminders for my class now. Okay, it's time for my class. For you guys, it's also late. Almost 1 hour, 45 minutes we've sat through. So don't worry, we have not finished the questions. I will do that. Proxy. So guys, the next session is on, kya did bataya tha aapko maine? Tuesday bataya hai? Can you all confirm, when did I mention the next class in your schedule? Yes, Tuesday. And on this day also, timing is 8:30. Yes, 8:30 will be fine for me. All the 8:30 for you means it's going to be morning. Okay, 4:30 for me, but that's okay. But I'll have to get ready for my class also. So I must have enough time for that. Okay. Pavan, what course am I doing? I'll come back, I'll let you know. Okay. So I will share the videos, I'll share the model answers also. Now you have a fair idea about what answer writing may look like. Please do the other questions, whatever you can. Tonight, at a 4 hour gap, my class gets over at around 7 or 8 o'clock in the evening. By then, it'll be 12 o'clock night at your place. Okay, so that becomes tough then. Monday, no problem for you, but I have problem because next day even I must wake up. Okay. Achha, listen now. So Tuesday morning you have a class, and the third class is for Wednesday. The Wednesday class will be taken by Vaishali ma'am, but I think I will need to reschedule it either Thursday or Friday, because I had thought madam will take the Wednesday class for you and I would have taken for CCMP, but they're clashing. That's a problem. Okay. So your class of Wednesday, that might get postponed. Wednesday will be shifted to either Thursday or Friday. It'll be Vaishali ma'am's class and environment topics. Okay. Shashwat, I'm not asking you. Okay. I'm telling this to you. Start accepting it now. Okay. And you'll manage. Any case you miss, we will have to look up the recordings. Broad schedule, yes, I will. Once this week gets over, I'll give you a schedule for another 2 days, 2 weeks. Okay. So let me plan that ways, and thereafter we'll continue. Okay, guys. So bye-bye. Okay. Thank you so much. You also please keep on working with the answers. And I'm sure by the time you finish off, you'll be fairly comfortable. Okay. Chalo. Bye-bye. Take care. Now I must run to become a student now. Okay, beta. God bless you guys.